Chris, for that fantastic start to the lecture. So I'm going to talk for about 50 minutes on things that you can do with monoidal categories. So Chris has set the scene fantastically, and we'll see what sort of things you can do with these monoidal categories and why they're relevant to quantum mechanics and quantum information. Which go from the unit object in the monoidal category to A times AL, and also epsilon, which is the morphism from AL times A into your monoidal unit. And these have to satisfy two equations. Now, once you get to this sort of level, it's absolutely ridiculous not using the graphical calculus, otherwise you've run into these obscenely long algebraic cubes, which you can't understand at all. So I'm going to write this out in its full glory, and you'll see how horrible it is, and you'll be completely convinced of not only the beauty, but the incredible importance of these pretty pictures, right? So the first equation we have to satisfy is lambda epsilon times identity alpha identity times eta rho equals identity, so epsilon AL. So you see that, and it doesn't really tell you very much at all. But if you write out what it means, you see that it means this. So this is my object AL coming in at the bottom. This is my this is my rho here. So I should draw this really. This is starting with just AL, and it's creating a unit object out of nowhere. And then I'm going to apply this eta, which is this map here. And then I'm going to do some little alpha, some associated in the middle. And then I'm going to do an epsilon. And then my lambda at the end takes this unit object that's coming out here, and it just gets rid of it. But we don't really care about these unit objects, and we don't draw them in the graphical calculus. And the axiom says that all of this has to equal the identity. So there it is, there's the identity. And the, so I think you'll agree that this makes a lot more sense, and it's much easier to see what's going on than this horrible algebraic construction there. So that's the first equation I have to satisfy. The other equation looks like this. So that's A, that's epsilon. This makes a huge huge amount of sense. Suppose you're doing some huge big calculation in all these monoidal categories, and you see something like this. Makes a lot of sense to you that you can just string that out. And it really makes things easier to work with. Imagine instead you had some hugely long algebraic expression, and you can just somehow spot this is hiding inside it, and you can replace the identity. That would be very difficult to do. So these really are absolutely crucial. These are really crucial constructions. So you might imagine you can also construct right duals instead. The way you construct right duals is you just switch around the position of A and AL in these pictures. So similarly, do this here. A right dual for A is the object AR. Here, that shows that as part of showing that AL is left equal to A. So this eta, I should really write eta A, because this is the eta associated with A, and this is the epsilon associated with B. So we started with that F that goes from A to B, and we ended up with a map. This is sort of a complicated thing. It goes from B out to AL.
Sorry, can you write your subscripts and superscripts?
Yes. Certainly can, sorry about that. Okay. So this is epsilon B. Eta A. Gives you a monoidal category, it might be difficult to work it out, but either it will be autonomous or it will be is autonomous, then either it will be pivotal, or both. Okay, so what's the use of this this pivotal structure? Well, it really lets you go to town with all these little string pictures you've got here. So suppose you have suppose you've got a bit of string, and suppose it's tied up just into a circle, and you have a table, you drop your string off the table. And suppose you're lucky enough that little bits of the string cross over other bits of the string, which is probably pretty unlikely. So let's say you get really lucky. Then, I don't know, your bit of string might... I have a bit of string I made earlier here, look. I should move it up here. So let's say your bit of string looks like this. This is quite a cool one. About that. Alright, okay, so let's say a little bit of string looks like that. And let's say that your string has some direction associated with it. Then if you're in one of these pivotal autonomous categories, you can pick some object, and then you can just say, this is going to be my object A, and then this bit of string, this could be a photograph of your bit of string, we're now going to interpret all these swirls and these things, these cups, these caps and these cups, as actual eters and epsilons that are arising from having your jewels. And of course you carry on this arrow through here, all the way around like that, and then you get a nice result. Says that suppose you drop your string onto the table in two different ways, such that these can be stretched into each other without breaking the string or without crossing over anything horrible. So this is another way that I can drop my string, and it's sort of obvious that I can stretch this out and turn it into this. And I can assign this with the same object to my category. And this gives me another morphism. These will actually be scalars in the category, just like Chris explained. And then there's a nice result that says that if your two strings can be defaulted into each other, then just like these two strings can be, then these things seen as morphisms in our category, in the way that we've just seen, will be given equal morphisms. And this is incredibly important, because perhaps we have... So I said that these are scalars, perhaps we have a category length category filter spaces where our scalars are just numbers. Then this has given us a rule to take some sort of complex topological pattern and turn it into a number in such a way that we're guaranteed that if we get two different topological patterns, which are topologically equivalent, we're going to get the same number. And in topology, this is called an invariant. Cooking up these invariants is typically quite difficult, but jolly important. So this gives us a sort of glimpse of the beginnings of a correspondence between topology and categories of duals. And this is of enormous profound importance in category theory. And it underlies the fact that the graphical notation works at all and exists and is easy to use or is helpful. Okay, so I'm halfway through my time and I've got about 10 minutes of my notes, so I'm going to quickly reevaluate what I'm going to do. Okay, so let's see a few examples anyway. So, the most important example we're going to work with is the category of filter spaces. Chris showed us that states of Hilbert spaces correspond we say that objects, objects like this are self-dual. So finite dimensional Hilbert spaces are self-dual. Okay, so what about infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces? Well, it turns out this doesn't work. You can try as hard as you can, but you'll never be able to come up with morphisms like this that satisfy this equation. But obviously these also satisfy the other exact equation as well. And sometimes you might think you've managed to do it, but then you'll find you've actually constructed some vector that has infinite norm, like some sort of horrible property that we don't want to allow in our kind of Hilbert spaces. So this is a strange property. This autonomous property is something that you often find is very finite-dimensional. Big infinite structures don't get along with it, but these higher-dimensional ones, these finite-dimensional ones, get to be very important. Okay. Okay, so we've seen an example of the category of Hilbert spaces. Generalize the theory of monoids in a enormous way. So what is a monoid? We have a set S axioms that we require in order to have a monoid. We require that for all x, y, z elements of S, we require that M multiplying together E and X just equals X, and we require that multiplying together X and E just equals X, and we require that multiplying together the multiple of X and Y with Z equals multiplying together X with the multiple of Y with Z. And we might call these two equations unit laws, and we might call this equation associativity law. Okay, so that's great, that's very important, that's a very powerful sort of structure to consider. The monoidal structure is important, so we just say hill along with this monoidal structure. saying that this multiplication morphism is just a morphism in this category where all of the morphisms are linear and stuff. So shout out if you've got any questions. Right. So maybe you've thought a lot that algebras over vector spaces look like monoids, and heavily theoretically it's exactly the same sort of thing going on. There's no difference at all. But once you've drawn things like this, you can really go to town. You can consider all sorts of crazy things that people never would have thought about if they didn't know any category theory. So, one day somebody probably thought, gosh, I've heard about these crazy category things, let me do something really crazy. Let me turn everything upside down. So they probably thought, what if I have? Study things where we have a multiplication, but it sort of goes the wrong way. We start with one thing, and we end up with two things. Is it the normal multiplication that takes us from two things into one thing? And what if we have some sort of crazy unit thing that instead of taking nothing and giving us something, takes something and gives us nothing? So what if we study these things? Well, they're called co-monoids. And this is a general principle in category theory, but if you have a definition, if you turn it all upside down, and a new thing, then you can stick co in front of the name. And that's a pretty useful way to keep track of it. Okay, so what about these things? Well, you might say, well, a lot of these look like in classical mathematics. What are they? Space H. So I've got a monoid and a co-monoid on the same object.
Jim, you should
go the other way. What's that?
The polyunit.
Oh, someone said it. Right. Okay. So, if you look at interactions between these things, in conventional set-based mathematics, you couldn't do this at all. Looking at interactions between monoids and cohomology on the same object, because cohomology are totally boring to give us any information at all, then we can't go fill the space to start to do this. So we can define something called the Frobenius structure. Now these are awfully important, and lots of the talks in here, the rest of this school will be talking explicitly or not about Frobenius structures. So if you have a monoid and a cohomology on the same object, you say that this is a Frobenius structure when it satisfies the following rules. Structures, we can find dagger. Frobenius. structure was a monoid and a comonoid. You know that a Frobenius structure was a monoid comonoid satisfying these nice Frobenius sort of zigzag rules. A double Frobenius structure is when we have Frobenius plus M equaling the adjoint of dagger. So if you have a Frobenius structure where this map is just the adjoint of this, and also where this map is just the adjoint of this, E equals epsilon dagger, we call this a dagger Frobenius structure. And these are really useful to us for a reason. Are useful things to study. where this axiomatization comes from. Well, I'm just going to finish up quickly by talking about this commutativity property. So suppose we've got all these Vicarian structures and we have these Hilbert spaces, and suppose it's commutative, then it must correspond to a commutative finite dimensional matrix algebra. Now the only commutative matrix algebras are the 1x1 matrix algebras. So the only way we have a commutative matrix algebra is if we get lots of these 1x1 algebras and we stick them together. So this is an example of a commutative finite dimensional matrix algebra. So the space of diagonal 2x2 matrices, for example. And the algebra operation, the multiplication, is just what you'd expect. It's just matrix multiplication. Now what's interesting about this, is that just from knowing this algebra structure, in other words, just from knowing your Dagger Frobenius structure, you can identify abstractly, in this particular example, you can identify abstractly these two elements as being particularly important. So why are they important? So why are they important just sort of as elements of this vector space? Well, they form a basis, that's the first thing to notice, and in fact it's orthogonal. Chosen basis, as I talked about here. So a finite dimensional Hilbert space H number of properties in our measurement that show how it forms part of a larger quantum protocol, for example. And this gives us a nice abstract way to talk about these very concrete things like Hilbert spaces and basis. And we'll see in lots of the talks